Welcome to the final episode of Wareham Gatemen Around the Horn for the 2012 season. Oh, Derek's tearing up under there. But we are going out in style. We have all of your favorite segments. We have tons of player interviews, a cooking segment with Jen, and Coach Maxwell shows you just how easy my job is. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the extended version of the season finale of Wareham Gatemen.
Ben Fontana joined by Wareham Gatemen manager Cooper Ferris as they get ready for the 2012 playoffs here in the summer in Cape Cod. And Coop, you've been here for a dozen years, and this is, I think, you know, the nth time that you've been in the playoffs. Is it getting old, or you're still having fun doing this?
No, it's every year. That's what you strive for, and you know, it's always an exciting time for the guys. You know, I told them yesterday, you know, if the championship series is unbelievable. I mean, 6,000 to 8,000 people. Yeah. You know, it's crazy, and hopefully they'll get to experience that.
And you made it in 2001, 2002 when you were first here. You made it. You won it all. And in 06 was the last time you guys made the championship series. So are you itching to get back?
Oh yeah. That's what you strive for. So you know, it's a fun time of the year, and it'll be something they'll never forget.
So it's a lot of fun here in the playoffs when it comes down to it. This is the fourth year the Gatemen have made the playoffs in a row. You guys haven't gotten that far. Last year you guys made the Western Finals, lost to Falmouth in three games. So is there any different approach that you take to this year's playoffs?
No, not really. You're just trying to take it one game at a time. Just, I know that's an old cliche, but that's all you can do. Tomorrow, there's nothing you can do about it. And, you know, there's nothing you can do about what just happened last night. So, you know, just try to come out and do your best and make some memories.
Well, let's look back at the last week for the Gatemen. They were actually lost four in a row going into a doubleheader, and then won the nightcap versus Chatham, have won four games in the regular season, and then five, including a playoff win versus Falmouth last night. And I talked to you a lot about how much momentum means, but now that you finally won a game in the playoffs, do you think it's going to propel you forward?
Well, I hope so. You know, you just, again, you know, it's the baseball's a crazy game. You know, the ball can bounce a different way and change the complexion of things. It's how you react to it. And, you know, hopefully, you know, we'll get some things bouncing our way.
So that actually made them the 2 seed in the West rather than the 3 seed. So they had a home game last night. And if Bourne, the 4 seed, would win, you'd have home field advantage again in the next round. How much does that mean to you guys?
Well, that's always great. You know, our fans are great. And, you know, they really support us even on the road, and you know, the big thing is you get that last at bat. If it's a close game, you can make some different moves and what you'd approach it differently as a coach, and you know, it's a great situation to have the home field advantage there.
And the last game of the regular season versus Bourne, a couple of officials from the Cape League awarded the Gatemen franchise with a couple of awards. The first one, Tyler Horn, won the John Aclaffy Awards, the best pro prospect in New England. He's from Middleborough, Massachusetts. So I know Tyler's been a guy who's just been hitting the ball out of the ballpark, 16 this year. So how much is that a big award for him?
Oh, yeah. That's, you know, we've had three or four guys win that award. You know, it's right here in this area, and I'm sure it's exciting for him because of friends and family are here. You know, I know down at Virginia Tech, you know, probably don't get a lot of family and friend support. I know his family supports him, but you know, but now these guys can come see him, and you know, it's an exciting time for him, and he's done well for himself this summer.
Yeah, talk a little bit more about Tyler. He actually set the Wooden Bat Cape League record with 16 home runs, tying 1988's Dave Statton of Brewster. I know he's been getting a lot of media attention. Has that really, you know, affected his game at all, or is he still just head forward?
Not really. Tyler's a guy that, you know, every day he knows it's a different day, and he doesn't really get real high or real low. It's a real you know, pleasure to watch him, how he carries himself. He works hard. He comes to the park every day with the same approach. And you know, he's worked on his swing a lot this summer. And, you know, he's just a hard worker. He doesn't sit around. He keeps things moving. So And that's the way you've got to approach it, you know, getting to the next level. You've got to work and grind and keep working and never stop.
And also that last game of the regular season, the Gatemen franchise is also awarded with the Commissioner's Cup for the second straight year for basically performance on and off the ball field for the second straight summer. So how much does that mean to you that you're part of this great organization?
Well, it's great. I mean, the organization does a great job. They really take care of our guys, which is what Mr. Wild wanted. You know, he always took care of our players and treat them right. And hopefully the coaching staff, you know, is emphasized, you know, walking a good line there, and the players have all responded. We've got a great bunch of guys this year. They like each other, and that's you know, pretty much half the battle there. You know, it's getting guys to blend. They fought hard all year. They've competed together, and anytime you get in the trenches together, it makes for a good summer, you know, and I know you've seen us with all the comebacks that we've had. We've never stopped. We've been down 7 runs and 4 runs, and you know, usually you don't see that much in the Cape. So these guys have competed. They played through injuries, played through adversity. They've done everything the organization's asked them to do. They've read to kids. They've been out in the community, you know, doing stuff, and that's what this is all about. It's a total team effort there, with the organization, the team, and everyone involved. So it's a good deal. I think it's actually the third or fourth time we've won it since the inception of it a few years ago. So I think 7 or 8 years ago. Yeah. So it's a good light to shine on the organization.
Yeah, it was a trophy made in 2004. The Gatemen have won it 4 times, most of any Cape League team. So you talked a lot about your team. Trust me, they're a fun bunch of guys. You know, they have a lot of laughs before and after the games. Would you say that this is probably the team that you've coached, or the team with the most chemistry that you've coached here on the Cape?
The 2001 and 2002 team had good chemistry. They did, you know, you see a lot of similarities there. The 2006 team, we've had some really good guys up here, and 2006 team was a good team. We've had some really talented players up here that didn't, you know, they were more individuals and they were team guys, and so we've had our share of both sides of the coin, but this team has been really fun to be around, and they know when to turn it on and off, so hopefully they'll keep doing that.
Well, this team is hitting really well. They've got most home runs in franchise history, I'm pretty sure. I talked about Tyler Horn, you know, tearing it up. So basically, I asked you at the beginning, you said that ultimate goal is going to be the championship. Do you think that this may be the year?
Well, hopefully, you know, you hope it every year, you know. But, you know, I can't emphasize enough at this time of the year how, you know, luck plays into it, how fortune plays into it, but a lot of times you make your own luck. And last night I've talked to you guys about this several times. The 2-out hit's big with runners in scoring position. The pitching is big, making critical pitches, which Kendall did last night. Playing really good defense, which, you know, we generally have done all season until the last, you know, week when we started moving people around, trying to rest people, but. You know, we you just got to grind every pitch, and that's basically how these championships are won, and hopefully we can keep that on a roll and keep doing that, because I think last night we had a pretty good effort.
I'm here with Sean Newcomb, left-handed pitcher for the Wareham Gatemen. And Sean, I apologize, I'm a little sick today, so probably sound a little funny. But you were named Player of the Week by the National Collegiate Baseball Writers Association, and it was the same week that Max Muncy was also named Player of the Week, who was one of our players for a couple seasons here in Wareham. Is that something that you're aware of, or is that something that you're kind of blind to?
Oh yeah, I was aware of that. I had to do an interview at school because I won that, and then it was on the website, so I saw that. And there was a link to it, and I saw him, and they mentioned that we were both Wareham Gatemen, so.
Now, how much weight do you as a player put on those kind of awards? Like, do you try to achieve them, or is it just something that happens because you're so wonderful?
Well, I didn't try to do that. I had a good week pitching, so that's how I got it, but obviously I go out to do well every week, and I did very well that week, so I got that.
Right, so it's kind of a byproduct of all of that.
Yeah.
Now, for the last month of this was your freshman year at Hartford, and for the last month you were injured, and then, of course, when you came here, you got injured again.
Yeah.
How are you feeling?
I feel fine. I'm back to normal now. it took a while to get back. It was like a muscle strain, so I had to be careful with it. But after a while, got back to normal and pitched a few times so far, so back to where I was before.
And does that affect how you play at all, having been injured a couple times? Are you a little more apprehensive, a little more cautious when you're playing?
Well, it took a while for me to get back because I was working all that stuff out, throwing pens at full speed just to feel comfortable. But by the time I got in the game, I was back to normal, so there was no hesitation.
Oh, perfect. And then you're from Middleboro, but I read that you were kind of neighbors of Spillane Fields in your early life.
I played my first varsity baseball game here for high school. My first start was here, and then I came here every year since because we kind of rivals. Middleboro is kind of a rival with Wareham, so.
No kidding.
Yep.
Did you ever picture yourself as playing here as a Gateman?
I always wanted to because I actually lived in Wareham first and second grade when I was little, and then I moved to Middleboro. And I always kind of just dreamed to play here, and it was kind of cool when I got the call from Coach Cooper. And my coach told me, so I was pretty excited about that.
Yeah, that must be so surreal. Did you ever go to a Gateman game?
Yeah, all the time. I used to come here every summer.
Okay.
It was awesome.
We're here with Clay Chapman, right-handed pitcher for the Wareham Gatemen. And Clay, you have started. You've done mid-relief. You've gotten saves for us here. You've done kind of the same thing down at Florida Southern. Is that a hard transition to go from starter to mid-relief? Is it hard to not kind of specialize in one thing?
It's basically just, you know, being a pitcher, you got to be able to do every role that you're given to. You got to be able to come out and start when you can. You got to be able to relieve. So being a pitcher, you have all those responsibilities.
And is it a different mentality depending on when you come into the game?
Oh, of course. As a starter, you got to be able to keep your endurance up. You got to be able to go from inning to inning and throw hard every inning. As a reliever, you come in and you have just that energy right away. You have to bring the energy to the game as a reliever.
Do you have a preference for either?
I like doing both. I prefer starting, but relieving is also good too.
It's very important.
Yeah, sure.
And you started here as a non-roster player, but of course now are a permanent player. Was that a lot of pressure during that window when you're trying to prove yourself?
Oh, yeah. You had to basically prove yourself and, you know, say that you're able to be here. You got to have the talent to be here. So that was kind of wrecking, nerve-wracking every day coming up and, you know, trying to do your best.
But you knew that you had it in you.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And what are you hoping to get out of your Cape League experience here?
Different, you know, learning different things and, you know, being able to help the community a lot and be able to bring it back to Florida Southern, all the abilities I learned here, and hopefully showcase all that when I get back to school.
Oh, wonderful. And so, like you said, you're from Florida Southern, which is about an hour outside of Tampa. You're originally from Orlando, from what I understand. So, in your professional opinion, what's your review of the Cape Cod beaches?
They're not around the same thing as Florida, but just because of the weather and then the water up here is so cold versus the water down there.
I'll give you that.
I don't go in the water up here. That's too cold for me.
Have you tried, though?
I have tried.
You have tried?
I have tried.
How far did you get in?
Shin deep.
Okay.
Down to my shin. That's it.
All right. I'll accept that. All right. But so for a real beach experience, we have to get down to Florida.
That's right. South Beach is the best one, I think.
Oh. So them.
Good place.
Them might be fighting words for some of our viewers, but.
Oh, yeah.
We'll try to forgive you. It's amazing the guys managed to keep their beach bods in top shape considering all the food they're given by this man.
I was talking with Bill Reed and John McBride, who did the meals. John also was the bus driver, which was a natural for the meals since he was there with them. And they got into a discussion about tipping in restaurants. And I was just sitting there, you know, was part of the conversation and listening. And I had recalled that at my church, we'd had a church supper recently, and we'd, you know, had 100-odd people there and took in $300. And I thought, jeepers, a church supper would be a good way for ball players to, you know, interact with the community. And Bill and John were kind of lamenting that they were getting subs all the time or pizza all the time. And, you know, the variety was lacking. And I suggested we try setting up some things with the churches. So there was some resistance and some, well, explore it. So they said, go ahead, Al, try it. So I started calling churches, and I met the head of the Wareham Clergy Association, who at the time was the priest down at Good Shepherd, and Father Dave, and he invited me to the Clergy Association meeting. And the team had authorized me to set up 5 church suppers, and I got 5 church suppers that morning. I had them all set up for the next year. And I came back and I told the church, and I came back and told the committee. And I could tell they were still skeptical. And then we had the first one. And after that, it was an idea that was embraced. And so it was through the church suppers that I got into the meals committee. And then John was getting old and he didn't want to do the bus anymore, although I'm convinced he could still be a good bus driver. But he said no, he was going to retire. He wasn't going to drive the bus anymore. He felt he didn't want to keep his license up and so forth. And Bill Reed was leaving the team. So John said, well, if you want to do the meals, Al, I'll help you with them. So John did the meals for a couple more years after that. And then he said, you know, you got it down pat, Al. You can do the meals now. And John moved on to the 50-50, where he is now, very capably. And the meals fell to me. And then I put together a little committee with Mary Chaplin and Pam Ellis and myself and my wife, Pam. And Mary and Pam Ellis handled the meals at the field, and my wife, Pam, and I handled all the other meals. And that's the committee that we stands today. We've added Tim Mitchell and Tim Walsh. And then also this year we got Lindsay the intern.
I've really enjoyed doing this so far. Basically what I do is I get a list of what the theme's gonna be for the night, and I put together what type of food we need, what everything is, and I send that out to everyone in the organization. And then people email me back and they tell me what they're gonna bring, and then I put out everything like this and we have a meal at the field. Well, we have the meals committee, and they help figure out what nights they'll be on and when we're going to have them and what the themes are. And then all the host families help bring food and all the different volunteers and everything. I started asking the players what they liked for food and started making sure I brought that here.
I start working on this in March. The minute I get the schedule, okay, the first thing I do is, do we have any big corporate sponsors that have to be accommodated? And I go into the schedule and set that date up. So I do all that, like February, March, whenever I can, as soon as I can get it. Then the meal is determined, where we eat is determined by where we play. So when we play in Hyannis, I have a deal that was already in place. I guess John and Bill put it in place as I was coming onto the committee with Scotty's Pizza. So we go to Scotty's Pizza when we play in Hyannis. When we play in Katuit, that's a field with no lights. That means the team gets back early, we go to a church.
It's very valuable, you know, for the boys to know who we are, and if they ever need some place to go, that they're welcome to come anyway.
And we're a community church, and we believe that, you know, a strong community is built with a strong church. So we believe that all the work that we do should be a good outreach for our community. And, you know, we just love doing this, you know what I mean, because it's the work of God.
You saw their faces.
You know, we love feeding people.
It's a kitchen every Tuesday, and it's for anybody to come in off the streets. We have people who have been with us since we've started it, and we have new ones that come, families that come. We go out to the motels. We give those people meals that can't get down here to get it. We're connected with the Boston Food Bank. And we have a Project Bread grant that we apply for every year. And then we have a big canal cruise fundraiser that we do once a year. And that supports the soup kitchen.
And that's coming up soon?
Yep, September 21st.
And the canal cruise is always a good time. You know, you get to meet a lot of people. We get a lot of people from, actually, as far as Rhode Island, people come. And
we have Connecticut. Know, yeah, we have a lot of people that came. You know,
and every single penny goes right back into the soup kitchen. Everything.
Yep.
If you consider the life of a college baseball player, remember, we're not just college baseball players. We're the elite. We're the upper echelon of college baseball players. These guys go to school before school starts. They go, they're there 1st of September, sometimes before. Sometimes middle of August. They have to go back to school. They start their preseason practicing. They play ball through the fall. Some of the big powerhouse schools like AZ and Georgia Tech and them. And then they go home for Christmas. They're home from Christmas to New Year's. While the rest of the student body's on break, the baseball team is back at the campus eating dorm food. And that's really what inspired the church suppers, was that I wanted to give them home cooking. And the meals at the field are the same thing. It began when I took the thing over. I set up a policy was whenever there's an autograph night, we'll do a meal at the field. Well, there were only three autograph nights. So one year there was four, and everybody was uncomfortable with that. So we began to add meals at the field when there were no autograph nights. But those games start at 7, and the game might end at 10, might end at 11, might end at 12. You never know with baseball. So sometimes the meals at the field are late, but the boys don't mind. They love to eat. These are, I've never seen anyone that could eat like a college baseball player.
And unfortunately for me, I've never seen anyone who could interview like a college baseball coach.
Miss Kate, what are your thoughts on the summer here on the Cape?
Oh, Max, I'm going to miss you.
I'm going to miss you too, Miss Kate. Kevin, what do you have to say about the season from your standpoint as a trainer?
It was good. We didn't have too many bad injuries, and you do a great job at first base.
Oh, thank you. That means so much. Miss Kate, what's your agenda for the fall? What will your primary responsibilities be back at University of Delaware?
I'll be working with the men's lacrosse team. So, yep.
What do you know about men's lacrosse, Kate?
Not much.
Not much. All right. And Kevin, I know your responsibilities at Wareham High. What will they be in the fall?
I actually think the football team's going to do well this year. I'm predicting 7-4.
7-4, that's a good season. How about soccer?
Soccer's not so much.
Cross country, I see we lost it.
No, I don't know. I don't know that yet.
I read in the paper today.
Did you? I don't know. I got to see what happens.
And men's volleyball.
It's coming. I don't know what's happening with the sports, but we'll see.
Well, Miss Kate, I know from the player's standpoint and the coach's standpoint, we're real happy to have you, and good luck and continued success in your life.
Thanks, Coach.
Kevin, we'll be seeing you around Wareham High. Yep. This is Coach Maxwell with Around the Horn. Thank you.
So I'm here with the newest blood for the Wareham Gatemen, Chris Huffman, Ryan Sullivan, and Dylan Stoops. So, Chris, you came up here from another league. How has it been coming up this late in the season?
It's not that bad, but just meeting new people and getting to know everybody on the team for the first couple of days. But it's not that hard once you get used to it.
Well, that's good. And Ryan, so you played with Chris.
I played with Dylan.
You played with Dylan, yes. Against Chris.
Against Chris, yes, in the Valley.
And how has it been being teammates now?
It's been pretty good. Chris didn't pitch against us, luckily, so we got pretty lucky down the Valley. But I played with Dylan, and all three of us had pretty successful seasons, and it's nice coming up with these guys and seeing them play in another league and see how it kind of pans out. So it was pretty cool coming up to play against someone I played against and someone I played with. So.
Now, Dylan, coming up from another league, do you feel that you have different goals coming here, being here for maybe at most 2-3 weeks?
Yeah, it's definitely difficult knowing you only have 2 weeks to show yourself off, because this is one of the biggest stages to do it at in the college level. But at the same time, it's a great opportunity, and there's no stress, you know, just come up here and give it everything I got. You know, I pitched this a lot this summer, and just keep going, you know. Just don't change anything in your daily routine. Just keep doing what you did to get you here.
Did you find that was difficult to do, given that you have completely different surroundings?
It was tough, like Chris said, at first, to meet new people and adjust to the team. But, after getting to know the team, the guys are great about it. I mean, striking's a little tighter, but other than that, just go out there and do your job.
I heard that you guys have gotten into the game show scene a little bit.
That's,
can you talk about this?
Dylan's a big game show guy. He can answer those questions for you. He's a ringer.
Our host dad happens to love to play Price is Right, and he also loves to whoop me at it. Not as good as guessing the showcases as he is, but I'm learning, and we're picking it up as we go, see what happens.
And this is a talent you had before coming up here?
No, our host family loves games, cards, watching game shows. We do trivia on the porch every day out of the newspaper, and it's been fun, definitely. It's getting us thinking.
All right, here we go. Hey, I'm Jen, I'm Jen Drinkwater, and I am here with two of my favorite pitchers in the world. We have the Grave Digger, Kendall Graveman, and we have Barrett Flashing Aston.
Right.
Right? That's right. He both of pitchers on our Wareham Gatemen. You are from which
Arkansas.
School? Arkansas, and you are from
Mississippi State.
So are you guys rivals by any chance? Like, do you guys play against each other?
We play against each other, but we're not rivals.
But you're not rivals.
We like each
other.
There's
some teams that are like really like rivals, right?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So anyways, we're gonna cook today, and we're gonna make chicken salad. We gotta give it a name. The Wicked Pissa Bullpen Chicken Salad.
Yeah, sure, sounds good.
For Cape Cod Chicken Salad. And we are also going to make the famous, you get to pick the ingredients, trifle. which is the snack, the dessert that I bring to the field all the time. We had some last night. So we're going to start with the cake because we need to get that cooking, and we're going to cook it in the microwave. So we did this last time. It was neat. You can cook a cake in the microwave. Did you know that?
Didn't know that.
It's really neat. So did you guys decide on what cake that you wanted?
I think we're going to chocolate cake with vanilla pudding.
Okay. So basically when I make my trifle, I just kind of mix and match what I think will taste good. And I put it together and hopefully it tastes good. Sometimes it's a success and sometimes it's not such a success. You need a cake, you need a pudding, and then you need some other kind of something in the middle along with whipped cream. And you can use fruit. I've made a pineapple one. You could use coconut. You can use chocolate chips. I've made an Oreo cookie trifle that's really good that you do with Oreo cookies and Oreo pudding. And that's really good. So we'll start with that. So here's the thing, I'm gonna make you guys do all the work. So grab the bowl, and you just make the cake like you make the cake instructions. So
I need 1 1/4 cup of water.
So there's a measuring cup, you gotta get some water, dump everything in here. So Kendall, you pitched last night, tell us about it.
It went well, we ended up winning 7-1, so it was a good team win. Yes. We played really good defense.
It was awesome. Awesome. So we're in the playoffs. We're really excited. We play Falmouth tonight at their home field.
Yep.
And we're hoping that this will be the last game against Falmouth, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Nope. We can win tonight and win the series.
We need oil.
Okay. Let's see. We need a half cup of oil.
Oh, here we go.
Wait, a what?
Oil.
Oil?
Sorry.
Say it again.
Oil?
Oil.
Oil. Oil.
And
oil.
Three eggs.
So okay, is that from a chicken or from the supermarket?
What?
Did you get that from a real chicken?
Like, did you?
Or did you buy it at the supermarket?
Oh, I bought them at a supermarket. Sorry.
I'm not good at cracking eggs.
How about you? All right, so I'll crack the eggs.
You got it.
All right, you can
How much oil do we need?
1/4? One half. One half cup.
1/2 cup.
All right. So you crack it like that. Look it. You just, and then you just try to make sure you get rid of all the, and if a shell falls in, then you just go after it.
Oh, looky there.
See?
Who knew?
Your turn.
My turn.
Yep. Awesome. There's a spatula right there if you want to like get all the oil.
It does have an R in it, actually. It's just
oil. Awesome. Okay, so we've put all the ingredients in there, and basically we're going to just mix it. Here you go. You can use a mixer. I do everything by hand. Because I'm Italian, that's what we do. And so, if you use a stoneware and you use a microwave, it only takes 12 minutes for the cake to cook.
All right, here we go.
Instead of an hour, I think the box says usually an hour. Usually it says, depending on what you use, like 40 minutes. So then 12 minutes.
Oh, we're putting the whole thing in there?
The whole thing.
All right, we're ready.
And then you want to, here's the spatula love. There you go.
You get that.
Spatula it all in there. All right, so now you're gonna take it, you're gonna put it in a microwave for 12 minutes. And while that's cooking, we're gonna start on our chicken salad. I'll get the recipe, but basically, all the recipes that I find, I kind of get a core recipe and then I modify it to make it my own because it's just, you know, you can get the main ingredients. And so on this recipe, it's going to be, we're going to add some things to it. It's chicken, it's celery, it's onion, it's grapes. So we're going to use red grapes. You guys like grapes? You can use nuts, walnuts. If you have a nut allergy, you don't have to use them, or if you don't like them, you can use that. And then you can use Miracle Whip or like a mayonnaise-y kind of dressing, and then you mix it all in, and it's yummy. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to start with the chicken. Now, I pre-cut some of the chicken, so it wouldn't take us forever to cut it.
All right.
So we're going to start with the chicken. So grab the chicken breasts. Here's the knife. You need to chop it into kind of big pieces. I don't know, think of your chicken salad when you eat a chicken salad sandwiches. Do you want them really tiny? Do you want them big pieces? How do you want those? So
You're gonna chop it so it looks kind of like pieces like that. We're also gonna chop the celery. Mm-hmm. Are you good at chopping celery?
Yep.
You just don't wanna do the onion, right? Because it'll make you cry.
Yeah, make me cry.
It'll make him cry. He's a sensitive kind of guy. All right. So when we cut the celery, we're gonna cut it in, I don't know, think of the pieces you want. I would maybe cut it up here.
And then cut it in halves.
And then cut it in halves.
Okay.
But like thin pieces. All right, so now we are going to cut the celery. And so we don't want any of this, okay? And we don't want any of that. So get rid of all that junk.
How small do you want?
I don't know, think of the bites that you want to take. Do you want a big gob of celery or do you want it to like mix in? That's how I think of it when I cook. I think of like, how do I want it when I'm having my sandwich?
Chef.
You're doing a great job. So tell me about your school. I know we've talked before. What is you're going to school for? What's your major?
Criminal justice.
Criminal justice. So he's going to be out there making sure that our cities and towns are safe?
Kind of.
If I think baseball it's doesn't work out, right?
A cup.
Right.
It's about a cup?
Yeah.
Okay. And we also need some onion. Mm-hmm. So I would say maybe like half that onion. I wouldn't do the whole thing. So cut it down in half, then peel it off.
Cut it in half.
And you said you didn't want to cut it, Kendall, right? Because you didn't want to cry?
I'll cut it.
All right. Just please don't hurt yourself. So Kendall, what are you studying in school? So if baseball doesn't work out, which I'm sure it's going to work out for both of you, but you know, you always have to have a plan B.
Mechanical engineering.
Mechanical engineering?
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
No.
No way.
Yeah.
Wow, so you're a really smart math kid.
Yeah, I really like math.
Wow. I'm a math teacher. Did you know that?
I didn't.
I teach middle school math.
It comes pretty easy, so I think that's why I like it.
So the next thing we're going to do is grapes. So we're going to pull out some grapes, so I'm going to give those to you.
All right.
And you know what? I'll just give you the cover. You can cut them on this with that knife. How's that? And again, you kind of want to... Really, it depends on how much chicken you use, depends on how much other stuff you use. So
it needs to be smaller?
I don't know. Think about when you're eating the sandwich. If you're crying, the answer is no. It's good. That's good. So put it in here. Let's tell everyone how much kind of we use. That looks pretty good. It's like half an onion, half a medium-sized onion. See, I'm Italian. We measure everything by the palm of our hands. We don't really...
By the what of your what?
The palm of our hands.
Oh.
We don't... Are you making fun of me again? We don't really like measure.
All right.
So this is about a cup. This is about a cup. So if you use the recipe, you probably use like a half a cup.
Okay.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm
good. You want to go into the bathroom?
No, I'm all right.
Okay. All right. So we're going to dump those in there. All right.
How many grapes?
Probably. That will be enough, and then I've already pre-cut some.
Okay.
So probably right, do good. Like half of those. And you're just cutting them in half.
All right,
we're gonna use all this onion. The next thing is you have to decide if you want it Cape Cod style and add cranberries mm-hmm. or not. I kind of like them. They give
you like
this
cranberries?
Flavor. And yep. then walnuts too. Again, you can eliminate those and not have those
in
there.
Do you have to cut the cranberries? You just put the cranberries just, where they are, right?
You can put it in a handful.
And okay.
It, yep. All right.
Just a handful?
You have to judge it by what you want in your salad. So if you want more or less, you can put more or less. Like I like walnuts, so I would put a lot of walnuts in because I like the taste and the crunch. But my husband does not like walnuts, so I would be making his own without walnuts.
So we're gonna put walnuts because he's not eating.
Yeah, I would put more cranberries in.
Okay.
Just because there's a lot of chicken. You may want to...
Good?
Yeah, that looks good. If the walnuts are too big, if they're like...
You can break them up.
You can break them up,
okay.
Yeah. All right. So the recipe on the website that I found calls for Miracle Whip. Which is like a salad-y, dressing-y kind of mayonnaise.
Right.
And
I decided that I was just going to use what I had in my house. So what I did is I grabbed mayonnaise, because typical chicken salad just uses regular mayonnaise. So I grabbed the mayonnaise, and I probably used about, I want to say, if you use the 2.5 breasts, you probably use a half cup of mayonnaise and a half a cup of, or maybe a little bit less. So dump those grapes in. And then we're going to dump this in. And then you're just going to mix it all up, and then you have to chill it for a little bit.
Okay.
And while we chill that, we'll start on the cake. The recipe calls for Worcestershire sauce, a little bit of Worcestershire sauce, probably to give it a little bit of flavor. I don't have any of that, so I figured we can do without. And you can salt it to taste. Maybe put a little pepper in it to taste if you like to. I don't like to typically add salt to my recipes, only because sometimes food has a lot of salt in it.
Right.
But it looks good, doesn't it?
Very good. So we just chill it for...
Yeah, just chill it, because normally when you put the dressing in and stuff, you like your sandwich cold.
Right.
So we'll chill it for a little bit, but just keep mixing. That looks awesome. Okay, so because these are only 4.5, we're going to use both of them. But okay. We'll do one at a time. You make it by the directions on the back. It says 2 cups of cold. It says fat-free milk. I have 1%. Okay. So it'll be low-cal. So dump that in there, and then we're gonna do 2 cups of that, and then we're just gonna mix it. Now, you're gonna grab that glass bowl, and you're gonna take half the cake. So you're gonna go like this, ready? You're gonna just take it with your hands. It's a little hot, maybe you might need to use a knife.
Yeah, it's a little warm, that's what I was asking.
Okay. And drop it in there and cut it up.
All right.
Okay?
So I'm gonna pour this in here with the...
Usually we'll wait until the cake's cool, but we're gonna make this right now, so we...
can eat it.
So I'll pull a spoon.
Just pour the 2 cups in here and mix.
Yep. Okay. Just kind of like spread it out, dump it down so it makes a layer. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And so what we'll do is we'll do this whole thing, one layer, then we put the pudding in, then we put the whipped cream in, then we put in that second layer, pudding, whipped cream.
All right. I need a whisk it.
A whisk it? Is that like a tool?
Do I need a whisk?
Oh, to whisk it? Whisk it, it's kind of like a Triscuit. It's like a specialty cracker, a whisk it cracker.
Almost.
Yeah, you need to. I'm sorry, I'm gonna make fun of you. But it's fun.
How's
Hi,
it coming?
Barrett, let us know. How you doing?
We're doing great right. Over here.
Okay, so dump that in.
Here we go.
And dump it all around. Yeah, and it's gonna mix in perfect. And then here's your spatula. So now, I'll do this. This is the little, it gives it some chunk.
Should we put 2 bananas?
Sure, yeah. I don't know, do you like bananas? Banana's not really my favorite, but if you guys like bananas, you guys eat bananas a lot.
Bananas, I like bananas.
Why?
They add potassium and keep you hydrated.
They keep you hydrated?
Keep you from cramping up.
Really? I'll take that, you guys are doing a fantastic job. We're almost done. Kendall, you are the master whisker. I don't know, is there?
I don't know the proper name.
Do you have enough milk? Yeah.
I think so.
Okay. All right, that's good. So now we are going to use the whipped cream. I have 1 container of whipped cream, so we have to split it. So we'll split it in half.
All right.
We'll put a layer so we can spoon it out. You spoon it out and put a layer and then just layer it down and then put the cake, the rest of the cake in. But you might have to, let's chop it in here in pieces because you might not be able to chop it in there. You know what I'm saying?
Yep. So one layer.
Mm-hmm, one layer.
All right.
Yeah, dump the whole half in and then just try to smooth it out. Job. See how easy this is?
Pretty easy.
Doesn't it look hard, but it's not?
It's pretty easy if I can do it.
I need a little bit more. I'll get you another spoon too. Here.
then we'll put this layer in there. Now, is it starting to, can you feel it starting to get thick?
I can.
That's what we want.
Right.
Like when it sets all together. Okay. What happens is I pour it in when it's like liquidy, and then I put it in the refrigerator and it sets, and that's, and it seeps into the cake, and that's how it makes it all nice and squishy and yummy. Now, what I would recommend is you want it to be pretty on top, so instead of putting the bananas on this layer, put the whipped cream next, and we'll put the bananas on top and make it pretty.
Okay.
And then it'll be all done, and you can just, like, kind of...
smooth it.
Smooth it. Mm-hmm. Looks good. Doesn't it look good? Here, I'll rinse this so he can smooth it with this.
Okay.
Unless you want to lick it. Do you want to lick it?
No, no,
you
I don't.
Sure? Every time, my daughter loves when I make cookies and stuff for you guys because she is the licker.
Which daughter?
Which daughter?
Jaden.
Jaden.
Oh. Yep. She, Mom, can I have that licker? Mom, can I have that? She'll watch me over as I'm mixing it with the electric mixer with her tongue hanging out, wanting to lick the spoons and lick the bowl and lick, she gets everything pre-cooking stage, I guess, for lack of a better word. Looks good. And you can see, look at it from the side view, how nice it looks. It's so yummy looking. I just might have to take that to the field with you guys. That looks good, doesn't it look good?
Okay.
I do say so myself. I hope it tastes as good as it looks. Generously. That's not generously. Give him another scoop. Generously.
All right, there we go.
You want some.
Good job.
There you go. Okay. Or if you want, you can also do maybe just a salad and put like a little bit on top too if you wanted that. Or you could even put some lettuce on your salad, so. But I want to try it before we end broadcast, so we want to try it. So you guys pick a sandwich. I'll get a fork for the salad. And we're going to try it, and then we're going to wrap it up.
All right.
You ready? You taste it first. No matter what, it's always right? It's got to be for the camera. Oh, it's really good.
That is good.
It's better than I thought it was going to be. What do you think?
Yeah.
That's good.
I might eat two or three of these.
So that's it. I mean, that's our, what do we want to call it? Wicked?
Wicked
Pissa Bullpen Chicken Salad with our banana trifle, which will come out after. Should we scoop some on a plate?
I promise you it's good.
It's good.
It's good.
All right, so thanks guys for coming in and helping us with the show, and let's eat.
That's all right. Thank you.
I'm here on the field with Dustin DeMuth. And Dustin, you've played every variety of position from second, short, third. You started doing a little bit more third this season in college, Indiana. Do you think that you're going to end up being there permanently for them this coming year?
Yeah, I talked to the coach a while ago, and he said I'll probably play third in the spring. So I think that's why I'm playing up here majority of third. So just trying to get the timing down and stuff over there. So yeah.
And how do you feel about that? Do you prefer the variety, or do you like being put in one spot, just kind of honing the skills there?
It really doesn't matter to me as long as I'm on the field. Third is fine with me. I'm pretty used to it now after playing freshman and sophomore year there, so anywhere is fine with me.
Now, so this last year, you had a little bit of a slow start in college, but then you started to get up there. You're third in multi-hits for your team, and then you hit 333 with us here. You were sidelined by your groin pull back in June. What do you need to do to get that momentum back, or what have you done to get that momentum back?
Just trying to get more comfortable in the box. Coming back from injury, I think my timing was all messed up. Wasn't very comfortable in the box, so just trying to get, comfortable in there and used to live pitching again and just get back in the groove.
You feel you ready for the playoffs?
Yes, of course.
Great. And you also played for the Florida Collegiate League last year. Have you noticed any distinct differences between up here and down there?
Yeah, definitely. The pitching up here is way better. Competition's way better. You know, it's Cape Cod for a reason. It's the best league in the country. So, you know, everyone wants to play here, and it's definitely a step up in competition.
Well, you've adjusted very well to that. And one more thing. So you seem like a very laid back, kind of quiet guy, but you were involved in a fight this past year. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, you know, going against a rival in Purdue, you know, it's a big rivalry in Indiana. So if anything happens, you know, tempers kind of flare, and they flared, and we thought it was a cheap shot on our guy, and, you know, we weren't happy about it. So bench is cleared, and the rest is history, I guess.
Yeah, I heard you even got ejected, but that it was revoked afterward, right?
Yeah, they thought I was the one that got slid into at third, so they kind of revoked that, and I think they just had to throw somebody out, so they threw me out. But it was the ninth inning. I didn't really have an at-bat coming up either, so it didn't really make a difference, I guess.
Yeah. So that's another peril of working at the corner, huh? Looking forward to that. Yep. Gatemen pitcher Fred Shepard joins me now. And Fred, your family was here at the game last night, you're telling me.
Yeah, they were. I live about 3 hours west, so it's good. They can come down pretty regularly. They've probably been to about 20 games this summer. And they come when I pitch, so.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, got some support.
Oh, that's great. And so did they have a chance to do that too last year? Because you played in the New England Collegiate Baseball League as well.
Yeah, they did. That was a little bit further away. I was way up in Vermont, but they got to come up and see when I pitched. And actually, I got to pitch in Holyoke, which is right near my house, about 30 minutes away, because that's in the same league. And that was fun.
That's awesome. Do you remember pitching against your now teammate, Tyler Horan?
I do. Actually, that was my first start down there in Vermont.
Oh, jeez.
I threw a no-hitter through six against them, and then we were winning. I was going to get my first win, and then we had a reliever come in, and he let up a bomb to tie, and we lost the game. But
Tyler, who is now tied with the league's record for home runs, so better to be on this side of the plate with him,
better,
huh?
Much better.
Now, you're no stranger to post-season games, and you went there both this past season and season before into the NEC. I cannot get this correct.
NESCAC.
There we go. NESCAC.
School baseball.
School baseball. Yeah. So you've played in the playoffs before. As a pitcher, how do you prepare for something like that? Is it just kind of regular routine, or you have to start to prepare for both starting and relieving roles?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure what I'm going to be doing here, but at school I came in relief. I think I was going to pitch a championship game, but we didn't make it, so we were down 4 or 5, so he brought me in, so I got to pitch once more before the season ended.
I think I might have an idea of what you could be doing here tonight, because you took BP today.
Yeah, I did.
And I heard you got it out near the 412 mark.
I hit one out.
That's not the way I heard it.
I hit one of those bleachers.
You hit it into the bleachers?
Are you kidding? Yeah, of course I did.
Okay, he hit it into the bleachers. So you're getting a Happy Meal then?
I'm getting a Happy Meal.
Well, congratulations. Thank you. I hope everything ends well for you, and good luck in the playoffs.
Thank you.
Lucky for Fred, he doesn't have to put up with non-believers like me. He and all of the Gatemen players and all the players on the Cape League have a built-in support system. They get their own families away from home for the whole summer.
So how long have you been part of or been hosting players? 14
years. This is what, maybe our sixth year, but this is our second year having Daniel.
This is our second year.
Second year.
Uh-huh. We started last year, had a couple of players, and we liked it so much we wanted to do it again.
Four years.
This is our first year.
How was it?
It's been fantastic.
Yeah.
We've had a great time. Well, we started going to the games when we got married back in 83. That was when John Wild just started, and we just like being outside. We were teachers. And I prefer outside, the inside. Mm-hmm. So it was interesting. I got hit by a ball the very first time, very first game. That sold us on coming down. And then we met John Wild, and he was wonderful. Really a prince of a man. And we just, when the house was empty, second floor became empty, because Raymond's grown children found other places to stay, like they bought their own house. Then we had room to have the guys. We started about 5 years ago. We used to live right across the street from Spillane Field, so we just started going to the games. And the more that we went, the more we became involved. And she started off as a back girl. I started with the 50-50. She became a back girl. And then security and camera.
Yeah.
It's fun to have them around because we're baseball fans. And, you know, we have a house full of animals. And
they usually always love the animals. These guys have a blast with the dogs. So.
Yeah, our dogs are going to miss them. They wait up for them every night. Yeah,
and they're always high quality kids.
Yeah, we've always had great kids, and it's nice. They're all. It's going to be. I will definitely miss them for sure.
They're good guys.
They're good guys. Yeah.
It's a history. We started going to the games in like 2004. When did you become first an intern?
I became an intern in 2009 or 2010. 2010, because this is my third year doing it.
And then we decided after that point, after that, why don't we take the next step and become a host family? And it was a lot of fun.
We just continued.
We always wondered about those host families, and then we became one, so we knew more of the workings,
like ins
of
and
what
outs.
Was going on behind the scenes and stuff like that. So.
Just to get to know them, to find out where they're from and what they're going to college for and what they want to do with their life.
All the guys we've had, I love them. They're like another extension of my family, and they're welcome to come back anytime.
It's a different experience too, like getting to know all these guys, and they're a bunch of great guys, so I love hanging out with them when we can, so.
Why do you like the guys coming to the house?
Oh, I meet wonderful new kids all the time. They're wonderful kids. They have manners. They're polite.
They're funny. They always play well.
Yeah. I don't know why. They send Alice and I the best players on their team every year.
Yeah. For us, it's really showing the kids involvement. It's getting them involved. It's showing them teamwork and responsibility about being with the team. And, it's just, I hope it's showed them, this responsibility and how important it is to be a part of something.
Oh yeah, it's very easy. Just a lot of friendly people, a lot of friendly families, and they just welcomed me with open arms, so it was very nice and enjoyable.
Be able to come home and relax and stuff, and then be able to get up early and go to the field and everything. Have people to, comfort and support you at the games and everything, so it felt really good.
Yeah, it's been a lot easier bringing us together. We have a car together too, so we're able to get around and go to the fields. We went to like get together with rides, so it's worked out well.
Oh, Ethan's been...
He's pretty quiet.
Yeah.
He's a better son than me.
Well, it's actually a home to go home to after the games, as opposed to staying to a hotel. It's a great family, and this is my second year with them, and I've enjoyed every day. And it's just a great time, and it's a home.
You get lonely in a hotel. It's nice having people around who care about you. So.
Crazy dog and cats.
Yeah, crazy dogs and cats.
We just enjoy athletics and all the people who are involved with athletics, like Dan. Just great, great kid. It's fun to be around him, and we enjoy it thoroughly.
Yeah, I love to go to the games. I don't know what someone would be like without the baseball game.
Yeah, and this is my first year, but Barrett told me all last year, how much fun he had up here and how great of a family the Moretti's are. And, I was excited whenever they took me in and whenever I was told that I was coming to this team. And so it's just really awesome to have a family that supports you like this. And, playing with these two guys, these two youngins, it's pretty fun too.
It's just like home. I mean, they take care of me as good as it could get. If not better than at my real home.
And they gave me like a lot of comfort and everything, so I felt really comfortable with them right away. I felt like they were my own family, so I felt really good with them right away.
Yeah, that made it a lot easier for me. Yeah, told me where everything is, how to get around, and it's just been great.
I mean, having a host parent that are good people are just the best thing. Like, that's what you hope for. You don't really want to get anybody that's not a good person and not a good family, so. We got pretty lucky in getting these two. So.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
It's worth quality. Real quality, yeah.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, they've been unbelievable. We came up late in the season as replacement players from a different league. Me and Sully played together, but we stepped right in like we've known each other for a while. They're just like family now, like grandparents. And I'm definitely going to stay in contact with these guys, see what happens. Yeah, I mean, we got pretty lucky. Like you said, we come up late. You really don't know what to expect. You could really be stuck anywhere, especially other places we were. A lot of people get stuck up in hotels or something. So to have someone that's there for you, makes you breakfast, someone to talk to when you come home. It's nice, especially since you're away from your family for the whole summer. It's nice to have like an extended family, basically, besides the team. So they've done everything for me. They've always been there, even if I had a bad or good game. They've always, when I come home, I'm always smiling. So it's good.
Well, it is a very emotional thing. It's just like when it's over, they're gone, and you just sort of lose touch. And last year, I knew that he would be back this year, but this year, he probably is
we'll,
not going to
We'll
come
keep
back.
In touch for sure.
He'll be back
Yeah,
next
we're going to go down to Atlanta and see him at Georgia Tech in the spring and, you know, keep in touch with his family.
Yep. Better.
Yeah, definitely.
Honest. Okay.
Definitely.
I know. We want to follow your career.
Hopefully I get drafted off, fly him down, yeah. You know, the big stadiums and everything.
Yep. Yeah, you got to come back up to the Cape again.
That's right.
And when you come up to play at Fenway, you got to give us tickets.
That's right.
Yep.
Right behind
like
home
do.
Plate.
We'll be definitely. Right.
That's our goal.
Yeah.
We've stayed in contact with everybody.
Definitely.
It's always, always stable.
Yeah, she's got the smartphone. She'll be texting and all that stuff, yeah.
Yeah, I'll be sending fluffing out of the Mississippi.
Yeah,
fluffing.
Yeah.
Thanks, Warren.
Jambalaya.
Yeah, jambalaya too.
Oh, that's right. You like the jambalaya. That's always been everybody's favorite.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Call them up early in the morning, real early in the morning, see how they're doing.
Yeah, the boys stay in touch. Definitely. Evan and Zach will stay in touch with them. And Dave usually texts them. And like I said, they're always welcome no matter where we are. All our boys are always welcome back. Even if they want some, they make it real big and they want to sneak away somewhere, they're always welcome back. They're part of our family now. They'll always be a part of our family.
Thank you so much to everyone who made Around the Horn possible, including my lovely producer and sometimes host, Derek Drinkwater, and the man behind the camera, Warren Randolph, our editor and videographer. Of course, head coach Cooper Ferris for coming in and talking to us every week, and his wonderful team of guys who let us stalk and harass him the entire season. GM Tom Gay and his fantastic organization, their members, their interns like Ben and Jared who came and filled in for us. And of course, our viewers at home, just like you, for making sure that this has been such a success. Keep your eyes peeled for a best of episode coming up very, very shortly. And be sure to send me some of your feedback. We'd love to hear from you. You can email me at Courtney@WarehamTV.org so that we can make sure there's a second season of your favorite show, Wareham Gatemen Around the Horn. The players surprised some local students at a I'm here with boring Fred Shepard.
This...
Step on it!
I can't!
On this episode of Around the Horn, we check in to Facebook. Is it too early to dub him the Gladiator?
This week, we follow the most...
I don't remember why this is a transition, but let's hope that it works. Kick your butt, man. Found it.
Step on it.
So on this week.
We have to switch our step on?
Step on it. Step on it. I don't know why I want to do this so bad.
I know you're laughing. Let's do it again. Can I do it one more time? One more time? Alright, so you're still rolling? Shall I try one more time, just in case? On this episode of Around the Horn, we check in with Wareham's 2012 All-Stars and do something else with some little people. Kyle Schwarber is a giant.
Step on it.
Thanks for stopping in.